radio show is sponsored by NatureNova.ca, where dreams, memories, imagination, and discovery soar. Nature Nova is all about wildlife adventure, outdoor discovery, nature interpretation, and image originality. Nature Nova offers dynamic nature programs and presentations for schools, museums, libraries, nature centers, and special interest groups of all kinds. Be sure to visit naturenova.ca and book your special program or presentation today.
Hello, this is Julia Whittup with Talk Story Radio, and we have with us this morning Jon Triffo, who's going to be talking about Peregrine Falcons and his new book. So, good morning, Jon. So, go ahead and tell us a little bit about your book.
I've just created a small book. I'm working on a much larger book, and it's going to take me some time to complete the larger book. So I thought, in the meantime, I'll just publish a smaller book, mostly for children, with the idea of maybe even getting it into schools. And it is about my experiences with peregrine falcons in cities. I've spent many, many years watching and working with and actually releasing peregrine falcons from tall buildings in cities, in downtowns and cities.
Wow. What do they find to eat in cities?
In cities, when they're very young, and we put them on buildings, and in the days when we used to actually raise them on building tops and then release them, we would feed them farm-grown quail. It's a small kind of a chicken-like bird. And once the peregrines are on their own, and we no longer have to release them anymore, and they're pretty much taking care of themselves, they're having babies by themselves, they're migrating by themselves, we find that when they come into cities, and whenever they are in cities doing whatever it is they're doing, they tend to catch and eat a lot of pigeons. And the bigger the city, the more they tend to rely on. They can go out and hunt other birds as well. They're very adaptable, but they tend to take what is most common, what is most numerous in the area in which they live. So if they're in an area where there's lots and lots and lots of pigeons, that's mostly what they're likely to.
And that probably makes some people in the city happy.
Yeah, it does. You know, some people are looking at it that way, in the sense of they're helping to control pigeons. But really, when you learn about predator-prey dynamics, you kind of discover that the amount of prey that's available in an area supports a certain amount of predators. So it's a little bit backwards to what humans like to think. But they do indeed chase pigeons a lot. And in some cases, they will actually keep pigeons away from certain areas and maybe even certain buildings.
So do people ever deliberately keep falcons to keep the pigeon population down?
Some places will try to attract peregrine falcons to nest on a particular site or if it's in a particular area, on a particular building, with the hope that they'll kind of chase away all the pigeons. And but if you think about it, the peregrines, if they're relying on pigeons as prey, they're not likely to stay in an area that doesn't have a lot of pigeons. So, again, it's back to basic biology, really. The peregrines will hunt what is most numerous around them the most. So, if there's lots and lots of pigeons, the peregrines will always be there. But if the pigeons do disappear, then peregrines will either have to find another type of prey to live on or move to another area where there's more pigeons to be found.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of I released ladybugs in my garden. But once they killed off all the pests, they left because there was nothing left to eat.
Yes. That's exactly what happens. In the case of the ladybugs, if you have like an annual supply that you can rely on, then every year you just release a batch and you try to control things that way. But then again, you need to constantly release them. With peregrine falcons, it's not quite that easy. We release them for a period of decades, really. And then once they start nesting on their own, the idea, the concept of releasing them, it didn't really apply anymore. So we're thinking in terms of peregrine falcons on a bigger ecological scale now. So we're thinking in terms of healing the ecology in areas where it's been damaged and prohibiting the use of certain types of pesticides that that are harmful to them, actually harmful to us as well. And hopefully the recovery of the species on a larger scale will take place. And that's really what's happened. We found, however, that peregrines seem to like living in cities anyway. In fact, we found this historic precedent for that. Back in the early to mid-1930s, peregrine falcons were occurring in New York City all by themselves. And we think it's related to the displacement of the eastern North American population of peregrines. Once they started getting wiped out for many different reasons, they tried to adapt, tried to live with us in cities. And we discovered in Montreal in the mid-1930s, it was in late 1930s, actually, we discovered if we put a sandbox on a building that a peregrine falcon is interested in, they will indeed have lay eggs and be able to hatch those eggs and raise babies. So that's what's been happening. So all we did was we facilitated this idea. We put babies on buildings for a while, fed them for a while, let them disperse naturally for a while, and after a while they started coming back. And we're finding that peregrine falcons can adapt to many different cities in many different places. So now a lot of cities all over North America, quite a few in Canada, in fact, and even in Europe, we're experiencing peregrine falcons adapting really well and living in cities. So it's just a matter of tolerating them, maybe encouraging them, maybe helping them once in a while, but basically they're doing it all by themselves now.
That's great. What kind of box did you say you put out?
It's a little, it's kind of like a wooden tray. And It could be anywhere from 2 or 3 feet across. And it just has a little bit of sand on the bottom. And what the male peregrine falcon will do is he'll make a little scrape in the sand. And if the female accepts it, she'll lay eggs right there. And the two of them will, they'll just take care of things all by themselves. In some places, they don't, it's quite rare, but they will find areas where they can lay eggs. And as long as the egg can hatch and the babies can grow up without being blown away by wind or washed away by rain, they'll do it all by themselves without any help from us. So we find some peregrines will actually nest on bridges, different structures where the babies are safe. And
do they make
the babies
nests
are not
like
safe,
regular
the
birds?
Eggs are, pardon?
Sorry, do they make nests like regular birds with twigs and stuff?
No, they'll never build a nest. The only thing they really do is if there's sand, they'll scrape the sand. Just make a tiny little, kind of like a miniature ditch. But they'll never really build a nest. They're not nest-building birds at all. But when they find a place that accommodates their eggs and their babies, they will keep returning year after year and keep having babies there for as long as they can.
So does your book talk about how to track falcons to your area?
How to track them or attract
them? Or
how
to attract them, yeah.
Yeah, the book I just made is it's a bit of a booklet, actually. And it's an introduction to the idea of peregrine falcons living with us in cities. And it's an encouragement for people to get out and pay attention to them, just to look up and watch them, find out if they're nesting in an area near near you, and to learn about them. When I finish the big book, we will cover all the details about how to attract peregrine falcons to a particular building. Fun thing about that is they tend to find a building that they like for some reason, and it's quite a mysterious sort of a thing. Once they like a building, they're just going to keep hanging on that building, and they'll keep trying to lay eggs there. Sometimes, even when the nest fails year after year, they'll keep coming back, and they'll keep trying. We have a situation very close to where I live, in fact, where there's a female who, for some reason, likes a particular building not too far from me. And every year now, a male will come and join her for a little while, and she hasn't been successful. She's been doing this for about 5 years now, and she hasn't given up. So someday, maybe next year, maybe next summer, if she finds the right place, if she finds the right mate, they'll make it happen. It'll be great.
That does sound great. And you're a wildlife photographer.
Yeah, I've been interested in nature and photography. Now, I've been interested in nature ever since I was a boy. And I used to try drawing pictures of nature, and I was never really good at doing that. So once I picked up a camera, I was hooked. That was it. And so I just started taking pictures. I was coming home with stories that nobody would believe about animals. So it was quite a natural thing for me to go out and start taking pictures of what I find. And before I knew it, I found myself in schools, in museums, and libraries, sometimes doing very large shows to sometimes large audiences and small audiences, and just talking about nature, all different kinds of nature. And then in Regina, Saskatchewan, I was invited to participate with the Peregrine Falcon Release Project there, and that was something I couldn't resist, because for me to watch peregrines, I'd have to go to wilderness areas, and it's quite an endeavor to do that. And you know, I can only do that for short periods of time if I did. So once they started nesting in cities, well, now anybody can go watch them. It's just the most beautiful thing. Yeah.
And I assume your book is full of pictures of them.
Yeah, I have to admit, ever since I was a boy, it was the big, glorious picture book that fascinated me the most. I mean, when you tell stories and you provide pictures of what you're talking about, it just opens up a whole visual side to that world. And really, when you're dealing with nature, especially with animals, any kind of animal, it helps to show pictures. So I'm going to try to, I'm appealing to young people best way I can. Just show the pictures of the birds and briefly tell what it's all about. And the beautiful thing nowadays is once you see the pictures and you read a little bit about them, if you get interested about peregrine falcons or really anything, it's so easy nowadays for a lot of people to just research their favorite interests on the internet. You can find lots and lots of information about that. So what I'm doing with my larger book is I'm going to try to provide information that even in the internet age is still difficult to research.
Mm-hmm. And would that include information on how to become a falconer?
Yeah. With becoming the interesting thing about the connection with falconry and the Peregrine Falcon Project is really fascinating, because falconers, the science of falconry, provided us with the ability of to actually keep falcons in captivity, match the males and the females up, and get them to lay eggs, and actually get them to lay more eggs than they would in nature, and then help those eggs hatch and get more eggs to hatch than would actually occur in nature, and then help the babies to mature. So we were getting, more baby falcons to mature than nature could provide. So we had this abundance of young falcons. So It was part of a natural sort of thing. Let's try to release them in certain areas, wilderness areas and in cities, and just see if the concept of releasing them until they can take care of themselves could be proven. And, wow, it proved itself better in cities really than anywhere else. So they really adapted surprisingly well to living in cities. So possibly was really the start of it all.
And you're having a some sort of event connected with the opening of your book?
Yeah, we're launching the book here in Toronto. And the best way to get information about that is through my website. It's called NatureNova.ca. And you can find all the information about that. And we'll post updates as well on there. And we're posting updates there. And we're connecting that with Facebook as well, of course. And there's actually more information to be found at uponastarbooks.ca. That's my publisher. And anybody out there interested in publishing a book like this, I highly encourage them to contact Jeff Alex at uponastarbooks.ca and find out all about it. For me, it's been a wonderful adventure. It's my first little book, and it's just the most amazing. It's just as exciting getting this book out as it was to get Young Falcons out. amazing. Yeah, it's so exciting. I'm tempted to try to get a series of books out, you know. So my little girl wants me to do the next one on porcupines. So I thought, maybe I could do a little booklet on porcupines and just go from there, from one different kind of animal to the next.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
I'm sure if people become fascinated by a certain animal, they'll find out more.
Yeah, I have hundreds of thousands of photographs of different kinds of animals and wildlife, and I have just as many stories about all of them. So it's sort of a natural to put the two together in a way, especially where young people might find it a fascination. And then it's all about getting us back to observing nature, learning about nature, and reconnecting with nature, because, you know, nowadays there's a lot of disconnection from nature, and it's not really good for us. It's not good for the planet. It's such a beautiful thing that when you wake up and discover nature, you want to wake up and discover it again and again and again. It becomes part of your life, and then once you appreciate nature in such a holistic way, then hopefully we'll start taking better care of ourselves and taking care of our planet, and things will just only get better if we start doing that.
Well, thanks for being with us today, John. Forward to your story, and we'll be looking for that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.